won't take too much time because our next talk is just 5 minutes, but thank you so much, Anella. Tom, why don't you come on up and tell us about the Hawaii project in just 5 minutes. Hold on to your hats.
Speed run, everybody. We ready? Okay, so I am Tom Oliver, coming to you today from the Pacific Islands Fisheries Science Center in Honolulu, Hawaii, so aloha. And I want to tell you in 5 short minutes about a major collaborative project that's part of this decision support package you've heard about, but that's directly collaborating with the 100 Island Challenge at Scripps, with Josh Maiden's lab at University of Hawaii, and with Cheryl Logan's lab at CSUMB. And our project is what you see scrolling across the screen here is going out into the Central Pacific and building sub-millimeter scale models of roughly 100 meter squared plots over multiple years in the same place, so we can track individual colonies for patterns of growth, mortality, and recruitment, especially through disturbance events like the big 2015 bleaching that happened in Hawaii. And specifically, the talk is focusing on 16 different sites where we hand annotated individual colonies in 3 different genera that are the most common and widespread in Hawaii, generating thousands of colonies and thousands of transitions across about a 7-year period. From which we can build size-specific models of growth, survivorship, and reproduction with real rates of recruitment from our monitoring data into an integral projection model. Now, this integral projection model is a demographic model that literally integrates across these disparate vital rates to provide an answer, a very satisfying quantitative answer to the question, how is this population doing? That is, one of those is the parameter lambda, known as the population growth rate. And you can see on the left real values from wild populations around the main Hawaiian islands of massive parietids over time. And those are site and interval specific estimates. And you can see some of those are doing quite well in the green. They're above that critical threshold of 1 where they're beyond replacement. You can also see many populations are well below that threshold, especially right after the 2015 bleaching event. But what's great about integral projection models and why we're hoping to use them as foundations for decision support that can inform restoration efforts are we can change the model a lot easier than we can change reality. So we can ask the question, what is the most efficient way we can go about elevating that population growth rate? And if that is not part of your restoration strategy, I would like to just take a cartoon example to demonstrate why it should be. Right? So if you imagine a cartoon population that is rapidly declining from a population of 20,000, losing 9% a year, if we do a pretty big restoration effort and put out 1,000 colonies into that population in 1 year, but do nothing to change that population growth rate, we have not done nothing. We have bought some time. We have pushed that population collapse by about 1 year. If we manage to mount a truly heroic effort and put out 1,000 colonies every year, we can fend off population collapse, but we, again, have done nothing to prevent that long-term decline. However, if by changing growth, survivorship, and recruitment, by affecting the population's environment or the population's response to the environment, we can slow that decline, move beyond replacement into potentially self-sufficiency for that population. How do we do that? Well, we've talked a lot about a lot of different ways to do that over the past few days and over the past few years. But most of those are very labor and cost intensive, right? So the question of how do we do that most efficiently is a really important one, a critically important one. And so a single example of what you can get from the kind of model we just built is what size colony should I focus on changing the parameters of, right? And what you're looking at here is a product of elasticity analysis. The lower the value, the more efficient it is. And in the main Hawaiian islands for massive parietes, the optimal size you want to be focusing on is about 12 centimeters, the size a little smaller than a bread plate. From the restoration perspective, that's a big colony, right? That's not great. If instead you wanted to focus on a colony half that size, you would have to be twice as effective at changing those vital rates. If instead you're focusing just on the smallest size classes, you can do that, that's great, but you're gonna have to have the same effect as that big colony, you're gonna have to be 100 times more effective. Maybe you can be, but that's the math. And this is, if we put the 2 other really common genera on there, we see that pattern is pretty consistent across all of them. With that, that's basically my 5 minutes. I also just want to say that we as a community are extending this model with patterns of coral thermal evolution we were just talking about. And we have a poster about it tonight that I also will be presenting because unfortunately Devin couldn't be here. So thank you for your attention. Thank you for your time. Thank you for my decision support community. I appreciate you guys.